Hi, folks. Thanks a lot for coming. We're going to get started. It's okay. Good afternoon and welcome to MOCAD as we launch our 2017 winter season with our main exhibition, The Architectural Imagination. We're getting it all started this evening with a conversation featuring exhibition co-curators Cynthia Davidson and Monica Ponce de Leon. Organized for the US Pavillion at the 15th International Architecture Exhibition in Venice, Italy, The Architectural Imagination presents drawings, models, and videos of 12 speculative architecture projects designed for specific sites in Detroit, but with far-reaching applications for cities around the world. As the home of the automobile industry, the free-span concrete factory, Motown, and techno, Detroit was once a center for American imagination, not only for its products, but also for its modern architecture and modern lifestyle, which captivated audiences worldwide. Today, like many post-industrial cities, it is coping with the effects of a declining population. Nonetheless, having emerged from bankruptcy, there is a new excitement in Detroit to imagine the city's possible futures, both in the downtown core and in its many neighborhoods. Believing in the potential of architecture to catalyze change, the curator selected visionary American architecture practices to address these futures. Today's talk will include a Q&A, which will be conducted by City of Detroit's Planning Director, Mr. Maurice Cox. Mr. Cox is an urban designer, architectural educator, and former mayor of the city of Charlottesville, Virginia. Prior to making the move to Detroit, he recently served as Associate Dean for Community Engagement at Tulane University's School of Architecture and Director of the Tulane Center, a university-affiliated practice operating at the intersection of design, urban research, and civic engagement throughout the New Orleans community. As you've noticed, we've left you some note cards on the seats, so feel free to write your questions now. During the talk, we will collect those and hand them to Mr. Cox, and at the end of the talk, we'll commence a Q&A with those questions. As you can see, with us today to introduce today's conversation with the exhibition co-curators is Robert Fishman. Dr. Fishman is interim dean and professor of architecture and urban and regional planning at the University of Michigan and teaches in the urban design, architecture, and urban planning programs at Taubman College of Architecture and Urban Planning at the University of Michigan. He received his PhD and AM in history from Harvard and his AB in history from Stanford University. And an internationally recognized expert in the areas of urban history and urban policy and planning, he has authored several books regarding the seminal texts on the history of cities and urbanism, including Bourgeois Utopias, The Rise and Fall of Suburbia, Urban Utopias in the 20th Century, Ebenezer Howard, Frank Lloyd Wright, and Le Corbusier. His honors include the 2009 Lawrence Gerkins Prize for Lifetime Achievement of the Society for City and Regional Planning History, the Walker Ames Lectureship, the University of Washington, Seattle 2010, the Emma Lorch Professorship at the Taubman College, Public Policy Scholar at the Wilson Center, Washington, D.C. in 1999, the Cass Gilbert Professorship at the University of Minnesota in 1998, and visiting professorships at the University of Paris, Nanterre, the University of Pennsylvania, and Columbia University. He's currently working on a history of sustainability. I just also would like to mention the travel of the Architectural Imagination exhibition is brought to you with support from the Deschler Group, GS3 Global, and GTM USA. And finally, thank you to our generous supporters of today's opening reception, University of Michigan Taubman College of Architecture and Urban Planning and Architectural Record. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Robert Fishman.
Thank you very much for such a generous and detailed introduction. And thank you for being here for this very special event. And of course, thanks to MOCAD itself for making possible the homecoming of this exhibition. Because as wonderful as Venice and the Biennale are, and as prestigious as the exhibit in the American Pavilion was, what's really important, I think, is the encounter of the exhibit with the city and the people of Detroit. Because I think it's only here that we can really begin to clarify the relationship between the architectural imagination and the city. The Venice Biennale, as I'm sure all of you know, is essentially, I guess we could call it, a world's fair of architecture. And within that wonderful and unworldly context, what comes to the fore in the exhibit is its relation to architectural theory, and especially to the long and proud tradition of visionary architecture in modernism. But it's here that this exhibit and its ideas meet the real test of its relation to the present and the future of this city. And of course, the question has been asked, and I think it's especially pertinent here, what is the relationship of these visionary, speculative projects that by definition can't be built immediately? What is the relationship to the present and future of the city of Detroit? And to me, I would assert there is a deep connection. And I would express that connection in a single word that I think brings both the city and the exhibits together. And that word is audacity. Especially, I might put Barack Obama's book, The Audacity of Hope. And again, if you think about Detroit and its history, what distinguishes this city from, say, Toledo and all of the other Great Lakes cities that are our neighbors, I think it is that quality of audacity. You see it with just thinking about Woodward Avenue. Remember that before it was an avenue, Woodward was a person, Judge Woodward, who came here in 1806 and encounters a pathetic huddling of shacks and log cabins, and he immediately declares, "Nature has chosen this place to be the great emporium of North America." And it only, in his view, it only needed two things. One was a new city plan. It needed a whole lot of hexagons, a whole lot of diagonals. And of course, he named the primary axis for himself. The other thing that the city of Detroit needed at that time was what any frontier settlement needed, which was a school of universal knowledge. And Woodward, in his strange mashup of Greek and Latin, calls this school the Catholo Epistemiad. And this school that he founded in 1817 still exists, actually, under a different name. That name is the University of Michigan. So sometimes audacity pays. And it wasn't just Woodward, of course. There was the audacity of Henry Ford, who declared that this would be the place that would put the world on wheels and create wholly new ways of production. It was the audacity of the automobile workers themselves in the 1930s and 1940s who banded together to form the United Auto Workers and to win against tremendous opposition from Ford and others the right to their fair share of the productivity, the right to job security and health care and pensions and all the things that that they want. And it was right here that the Reverend C.L. Franklin in 1963 and other black leaders had the audacity to organize the largest civil rights demonstration that the country had ever seen, led by the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, where he had the audacity to proclaim that it would be in Detroit, where Black Americans would finally reach the equality and justice that they deserved. So a lot of audacity. Now, it's true that this hope, this has been difficult to find in the last 50 years or so. And so a great many people have responded to this exhibit by saying that its audacity, its hope, its imagination has no relationship to the city of Detroit as it actually exists. Well, I would like to present a different way of looking at that. I think the audacity of hope was strong here, even in the bad years, but it went local. For so many people, in this time of depopulation, the loss of so many vital city services over the decades of the end of the 20th century, it was a visionary project just to maintain your own house. But people, the people did more than that. They banded together in neighborhood organizations. They watched out for each other. They helped to repair their own houses. They mowed the lawns of their neighbors. They planted the community gardens and created the pocket parks. So these were visionary projects, in my view, at the neighborhood scale. And now we're finally at the point in the city where this local audacity of hope can become a citywide audacity of hope, where we can finally work at the city level. And to me, it's an actual responsibility of architecture to match this local audacity of hope with our own architectural imagination. Because really it's only architecture that can literally foresee a better future, can envision a different relationship between city and suburb, can see Detroit again as the center of a prosperous and united metropolitan region. So to me, it's part of the very mission of architecture itself to engage in this kind of architectural imagination, and an imagination that can not only help to rebuild the city of Detroit, but also perhaps to recast and re-energize architecture itself. So today we're privileged to have with us the co-curators of this wonderful exhibition, who you'll be hearing from in a moment, Cynthia Davidson, who is the editor of the distinguished architectural journal Log, and Monica Ponce de Leon, who is now dean of the School of Architecture at Princeton University, and just happened to have been dean at the Taubman College. I'd like to welcome them to our stage for a discussion, to be followed by a response by the City Planning Director, Maurice Cox.
Listen to you for the whole 2 hours about Detroit Thank you very much for that. Before we make our presentation, which we hope won't take up too much time because of the work in the gallery speaks for itself, we do want to thank a few people, beginning with Monty Luke, who introduced this afternoon's program, who's a part-time job as program director here at MOCAD. And especially to thank Alicia Orley-Reeder, the director of MOCAD, for sticking with us for 18 months with in mind that she would bring this show, or she would take this show, I should say, if we brought it to her, so that Detroit audiences could see what the world saw last year in Venice. And especially to thank Zeb Smith and his installation team, who have worked tirelessly to install this exhibition, which Monica and I couldn't be more excited about seeing in a new context. It takes on a whole new kind of exuberance and aura. So our talk is the third talk that is occurring this weekend. Last night we began with a presentation in Eastern Market at a gallery, Inner Street Gallery on Gratiot, where the three architects who were assigned the De Quinter Cut site presented briefly their projects and their ideas behind their projects to a local audience, and we had a very lively discussion afterward. This morning in this space, again to a very nice sized audience, the architects who worked on the Packard plant site, as well as the team that worked on the post office on the riverfront, also presented their ideas to an audience, which was followed by a discussion. And tomorrow, the architects who worked on Southwest Detroit Mexican Town will be presenting at the Southwest Detroit Business Association at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And we stage these conferences precisely to re-engage the neighborhoods and the individuals that the architects all worked with some 18 months ago.
We also have children's programming a week from today in the galleries, so I hope that you spread the word and that you bring as many kids as possible.
This exhibition is about architecture, and this exhibition is about Detroit. For all of the hard times and the difficulties that this city has faced over the last, let's narrow it down to 20 years, it also remains a place of inspiration and imagination. One reason Monica and I wanted to do something with people in Detroit for the Venice Biennale. To frame our talk today, I'm just gonna start with a little bit of a 1971 video, low resolution, that I hope needs no introduction.
So for Cynthia and I, it was very important to use architecture as a way of starting a conversation about public space in Detroit. We decided that one way to do this was to apply to be the co-curators of the installation of the American Pavilion in Venice, which happens, as Robert explained, every 2 years, but with the idea that it will become a catalyst for producing work that then will generate ideas that we can then debate in public here in the city. Now, for us, architectural imagination is important because it puts on the table possibilities outside of economic interests. It puts on the table ideas outside of a certain political group or a certain a contingency. We wanted these conversations to be open to anyone so that we could all project our own desires and our own ideas. Then we were very lucky and very honored that the State Department chose us to be the co-curators, but we had actually very little time to put it together after we were selected, because the time frame from the moment of selection to the moment of the opening is very, very limited.
The theme of the Biennale in 2016 was established by the director, a Chilean architect named Alejandro Aravena. And the image that Alejandro selected to convey what he felt his Biennale was about is this photograph, which shows an archaeologist on a ladder overlooking a desert landscape. And this woman walks on lands, different landscapes, carrying a ladder. So when she climbs the ladder, she gets a different view of the terrain. And we felt very strongly when we, although we had already proposed this project on Detroit before Alejandro was named the director of the Biennale, we were very pleased with his theme because we felt in many ways what we were doing with our proposal is perhaps getting a ladder to look at Detroit from another perspective.
Very early on, we put together an advisory board that included people from Detroit, working in Detroit, that came actually from different areas of the city, but also that belonged to different organizations, as a way of helping us frame the process, but also helping us select the sites where we will be doing these imaginary proposals.
Just to quickly review for those of you who may not know who was working on this, they included Alicia, the director of MOCAD, Maurice Cox, who was only a few months on the job, and therefore he would work with
it. Actually, I think he was like weeks in the job.
We managed to hook him in before he knew what was happening. People like Tony Griffin, who had worked on Detroit long-range plan, who's kind of the mobility of society. Many of these people have changed places. Tony's no longer in New York, she's now at Harvard. Dan Kincaid, who was with Detroit Future City, is now with the Smith Group. So people are always moving around. People like Tom Sherry, who came to Venice to see the show, and Milton Curry. It was really a very exciting, dynamic group of people.
So we, at the very beginning, we had a one-day retreat where we were looking, where we asked all of the members of the board to come in with a proposal as to which sites would be useful to investigate in the city. And we actually started with 20 different sites. And what became clear very early on is that there is so much happening in downtown and in the core that where we should be really investing our time would be outside of the core.
So the 7 sites that the board left us with, Monica and I revisited, and we selected the 4 that you see outlined here, none of which are in the core itself because there's enough activity in the core that we didn't want to mess with that. So the first site being in Southwest Detroit, in Mexican Town, Riverfront Post Office number 2, 3 in the Dupinder Cut, just east of Eastern Market, and the new part of the cut that the Detroit Riverfront was opening last year, and the Packard Plant, in part because it's such an iconic, internationally known ruin, shall we say.
So the 4 sites were chosen because they represent different issues that we think are essential to understanding Detroit, but also where Detroit can make a huge contribution to the world at large. We think that there's a lot that other cities can learn from Detroit, and we thought that these sites will really help understand the kind of imagination that those who are living in Detroit today are putting into changing the city and thinking of the city for the future. We did a national call for proposals. We got about 250 letters of interest. From those 250 letters of interest, we chose 12 teams. We are really excited of the diversity of the teams. We have a big range of age groups represented. We also have a big range of geographical areas. They came all over from all over the US, including Michigan and Detroit, but also very different backgrounds and very different approaches towards design. And I think that that's also reflected in the range of ideas that were put on the table.
So a little bit of what we're going to take you through now is going to include a few views of the installation in Venice itself, so that those of you who were not able to be in Venice can get some sense of how we tried to present this project to the international community. The pavilion itself is a neoclassical pavilion with a rotunda and two equal arms. Four rooms, which is why we chose four sites, one site for each room. When you walked into the rotunda, you were immediately greeted with the architectural imagination text, the same text that's here, only here it's also in Italian, and a map to help orient the visitor to the four rooms. One of the projects that we did to involve Detroit in the exhibition in ways other than imagining new ideas for the city was to ask people how they see their city. So we ran a postcard contest called My Detroit Postcards, for which we had over 450 entries, from which we selected 20 photographs. The photographer and sociologist Camillo Vergara chose these with me. And these are the postcards on display in Venice, as they are once again repeated here in this exhibition. So these were the views of many of the people who took these photographs live in the city, but it wasn't a requirement that you live here. It was only a requirement that it be of Detroit.
So as Cynthia said, the pavilion in Venice has four rooms, which meant that we worked with four sites so that we will have a clarity to the arrangement in the exhibition. We decided that three different teams will be operating in each site, and we wanted them to come up with different proposals. The teams did not collaborate with each other, and in fact, most of them did not know what the other team was working on, precisely so that we could put on the table options. We're not interested in an exhibition that proposes a solution or a single solution as if anyone knows best or as if we know best. But instead, we wanted to put a variety of options on the table, again, to generate discussion and to generate conversation. And in fact, we're hoping that it will generate debate and disagreement. So one of the first rooms when you come into the pavilion was dedicated to a site in Mexican Town in Southwest Detroit. And in this photo, you can see the three models from the different teams basically adjacent to each other. The site that we chose is actually very representative of other conditions in post-industrial cities. Mexican Town is thriving, and it's thriving because it has a community that has a very strong and clear identity. And yet, we have a site in the middle of this thriving community that has fallen into disuse and that has not generated things that the community needs. There is a great deal of need for public space, public buildings, and the site instead has remained in the margins. So the architects were asked to propose ideas not only in terms of forms of buildings, but also programmatic ideas. What are the kinds of uses that should happen in this site?
And in that sense, Monica and I, as curators, had to also become a little bit like a client on behalf of each of these communities, asking the architects to show us programmatic ideas before they began to draw architectural ideas. We have no idea which way they actually did that, but we kept in touch with them through WebEx conferences and telephone calls and all the ways one can communicate today.
And we should say that there's a difference since the client, since the architects were all volunteering their time, and all the work that you saw was done without any kind of remuneration to the architects for their time. We were not real clients. So in fact, there's a lot in the show that Cynthia and I don't necessarily agree with, or like, or dislike. but we did wanted to create a framework where there was, again, a conversation about what kinds of programs may be appropriate in sites, such as these ones.
So I'm going to take you a little bit through the process of what happened on each site. We don't want to try to explain the architect's work to you. That's incumbent upon them to explain. And nearly 10 out of the 12 teams are here today. And after this event, I'm sure you will find them in the gallery and you can collar them and say, why did you do that? Or, golly, that's a fabulous idea. I hope there's a little more of the latter just for their egos.
I think it's 11 out of the 12.
Well, whatever. as you see here in the center of this photograph is Detroit's distinguished director of planning leading a tour of the exhibition in Venice, which he did one weekend in October. Unfortunately, somebody caught him in the act. And he will tell you that he led several tours that weekend through the exhibition. That doesn't mean he likes the exhibition any more than we do. this is the project by Florencia Pita and Jackie Bloom. You can see quite literally in this study diagram their struggle with this triangular site and how do you do something that's triangular, that changes in grade, that has a railroad on one side, busy streets on the other two sides, and a very prosperous neighborhood to the east. This also, in this image, we see different studies they did from looking at the layers of paint that are on the site and thinking about how they might color the buildings on their site. And I think when you see the model, you'll begin to understand. I mean, all this material is also hanging on the wall, but I simply want to point out this step about their project and thinking about this project. For Monica and me, the most important thing about this exhibition, maybe I should say just for me, is that architecture is about ideas, and what is in the other room is about ideas. It's not about forms that Detroit or any other city must build or must replicate. It's about putting ideas into circulation that are here represented through architectural thinking. This is the Ann Office Project, which is a study of the site, the tiny triangle, and its relationship to neighborhoods in the city, and a neighborhood that's going to incur displacement of residents when the new bridge to Canada is built. This was one of their concerns, thinking about how to add density to the site in Mexican Town. What happens to those people that are displaced? Can they be resettled in Mexican Town? And this is a study by Max Scott and Merrill Elam Architects of Mexican Town. It's a very large collage you'll see on the wall. It's probably one of the most surprising things in the exhibition for Monica and me, but a very lyrical response to the number of visits and people they met while working on the Mexican Town project.
The second site that we want to share with you is the site along the western side of the riverfront, where the large post office confronts the water. And you can see just by looking at the image that the three projects took very different strategies and very different approaches towards this question. This site was important to us because it's not uncommon actually for industrial cities to give their back to the river, to the water's edge. Detroit is not alone in this condition. Many cities confront this very issue. And as cities move away from industrialization, they're wondering, what do we do with the water's edge? And actually, Detroit has done a great job with very little resources in revitalizing the waterfront, but this is a side of the city that has not been touched yet. One of the reasons it hasn't been touched is that the post office really blocks the connection between the city and the water, between Cork and the water. So we asked the architects to think about how to transform the large volume of the post office, which is not completely filled and not completely being used, how to transform the building and the space between it and the water as a way of thinking of a different way of occupying public space. Again, the three solutions radically different from each other. And for us, it was important that this be so that you actually could compare and contrast.
It's another tour shot of Mr. Cox and friends and people gathered around the model of Preston Scott Cohen, which one might add is one of the more controversial projects formally in the exhibition. This is the Bear Valier project, which if some of you were here this morning, you heard them discuss, where they sort of cut into the post office in order to provide passageways through the building. One of the things that Monica and I did not want the architects to do is to tear down buildings that were reusable. This was not an exercise in adaptive reuse, but an exercise in reimagining that did not necessarily involve demolition on sites where demolition really isn't necessary. This is an image of Scott Cohen's project. I chose this particular image, although it's not processed, it's kind of a finished presentation drawing. If you see down in the your left, this floating series of catenary arches with a green roof, which gives it a little bit of an idea of a lily pad in my mind. But what's important is to see the kind of outward energy of the idea, the project, the openness of the idea of the project, and in counter distinction to the inward pull of the Renaissance Center to the east, and that he was playing off conceptually everything about the Renaissance Center that has been criticized and trying to turn that around conceptually into another kind of architectural object that was more open. And the third project expanded way beyond the site by present future to architects in Houston who investigated the Hans Woodlands and thought that this idea of planting trees, more trees in Detroit, was in fact a way for Detroit to sequester carbon and then sell carbon credits that the city could then use that additional funding to support public works projects. And so they plant a great number of blocks solidly in trees, which would later be harvested as timber. And the timber would be used for timber construction. And if any of you are following what's been happening in architecture lately, there's a lot of investigation on building high, tall buildings in timber today.
In every one of the rooms, we decided to not present finished projects, but to actually show process thinking. So as you walk around the exhibition, you're looking at the different ways in which architects think about public space and the different ways in which architects think about buildings. We wanted to demythify this idea of the architect as being somebody that comes up with all the solutions, and instead for us to expose the different ways in which architects struggle with the production of ideas. This photo represents the room in Venice, shows us the room in Venice where three architects were dealing with the quintercut, and a particular moment in the quintercut where it hits Eastern Market. We chose this moment in the quintercut because, again, it represents a bigger idea that post-industrial cities deal with. And actually any city, when dealing with a piece of infrastructure that becomes a barrier between two sides. And in the case of the quintercut, Eastern Market has been extremely successful as an area and as a zone in the city, whereas immediately east of the cut, you can see how the city has not had the same kind of vitality in recent times. So we asked the architects to think about this moment and how by rethinking the cut, you may actually arrive at a different way of understanding place. When you walk through the show, you'll see that the approaches and the modes of representation of the three architects is radically different, as is their process. And when you look at their process, their model making techniques, you'll see how they think about making very differently, but they also think about space very differently.
After the discussion we had last night at the Interstate Gallery, very interesting. I wish I'd been a fly on the wall to hear what Maurice Cox was saying about Marshall Brown's project in Venice. As part of the process, this is part of the process of Andrew Zago architecture. They also went beyond the site, not quite to the same extent that Present Future did in Corktown. But I think it also shows how the architects, particularly in those two instances, were thinking way beyond the impact of an individual building on an individual site, but architecture's relationship to the city. So here they have buildings in alongside the cut, but they also expand down Gratiot with plantings and a new public food hall built on a closed ramp to Interstate 75. This is one of Marshall Brown's study drawings when he was trying to think about how to use both sides of the cut. We thought it's the smallest site of the four sites, but a very challenging one because the cut runs between it. Does an architect do two different things, one on each side? Does the architect bridge the site? There were many different options to think about how to deal with this.
You come down to the cut,
yeah,
so that you're connected to the rest of the city.
And this third image is from the process of Moss, who did a kind of high-density live-work space where there really isn't any street frontage. One of the fascinating things I think about their project was that they also worked through how they might consider using more easily available, perhaps less expensive materials not typically used in housing, such as concrete slabs that are made for highway bridges or spiral ramps that are used in parking garages. And you will see in their project how they tried to marry these different materials from their use of other types of construction that might make a vital new neighborhood in the east of Eastern Market.
And then the final site that we chose, as Cynthia said, is the Packard plant. Urban blight is something that many cities across the globe are dealing with. It's a big challenge for, again, post-industrial cities. And the Packard plant has become the poster child globally for a post-industrial building that has really had a huge impact in its neighborhood. So we charged the three teams with rethinking the Packard plant and imagining a different future for it. The extent of the building was one that was significant, and we are I am impressed that all three teams actually dealt with the home. At the beginning, I was worried that there would be a team that would deal just with one piece of the Packer plant. The three teams were brave and took on the challenge of the entire building.
Stan Allen surveyed the building, not in terms of square feet, but in terms of acres, and discovered that if you count all the floor space in the Packer plant, there are 100 acres in the plant, which may have influenced his decision to think about the idea of a botanical garden on the roof of this plant. These drawings show the exploded axonometric drawing, shows different ways that they thought about plugging in different programs into this building, and that they would use it as a kind of urban infrastructure, to think of the building as a piece of infrastructure and not just as a building. That's kind of a fine thing to try to parse right here, right now, but maybe Stan could tell you more about that. The team from Ann Arbor looked at the Packard plant not as a potential subject for demolition that would fill a landfill, but rather as a resource for material that could be repurposed by combining it with plastics to make new kinds of buildings, building materials. And their project is also an exercise in how they might use these new kinds of materials produced on that site from brick and wood and metal and things that might be pulled out of that plant or any other demolition site in this city or beyond this city limits, and how that kind of building material might be used to make new kinds of forms. And Greg Lynn Form used drones to study the site, and if you can see in this study drawing, using the drone footage to try to then draw over it to put a new academic and research community on the roof of a factory, a former factory structure.
So this is actually the pavilion, and this is the courtyard of the pavilion. We were told by the Guggenheim, who manages the pavilion in the Biennale, the Giardini in Venice, that it was very important to do an installation in the courtyard, because the installation in the courtyard became a sign for the exhibition inside. And the idea that we came up with was to pick up on the language of the columns of the building itself and fill the courtyard with columns, almost like a hypostyle hall. So the columns became a sign, a totem, that will have the name of the exhibition. But it was important that these columns represent the diversity of the city of Detroit. I became enamored with the Detroit flag and the fact that the Detroit flag has 13 stars. The reason why 13 is interesting to me is because it's indivisible, which means that in its variety, the 13 is actually something that you cannot break apart. So we decided to use the columns as a multiplicity of signs. So instead of a single sign for the American Pavilion this past year, one were many signs. We ended up truncating some of the columns so that we would have benches, because there is no seating near the pavilion. And we ended up with 8 freestanding columns out of the 13 stars. The shape, actually, of the columns comes from the top being the shape of a different star that merges into the drum of the base of the columns. And the languages that we ended up choosing to inscribe the columns with come from the 8 most common languages in Detroit. So as you approach the pavilion, the intent is that the diversity of Detroit will already be represented at its entrance. You know, the two of us are up here, and but the truth is that the exhibition can only be the result of a collaboration with many. And what was what is really amazing for us is that as sponsors of the pavilion is not only your typical academic institutions. You can see Harvard, you can see Princeton, you can see SIARC up in the screen. But also really important was the variety of folks that supported the exhibition. Architectural Record was our media partner, and they are here today. But also there were individual donors, like Alice Jaffer and Jeffrey Brown, who paid, I mean, who funded the catalog. And the catalog is at the in the reception if you want to take a peek. But also how many companies from Detroit and foundations from Detroit supported us. And as we said at the beginning of the talk today, the exhibition would not have been able to travel to Detroit without the support of Deschler, GS3, and GDM. So we're really grateful to all of those who collaborated and contributed. And if I left somebody out, please forgive me.
It does take a team. I often think of Hillary Clinton's great book title, It Takes a Village. It did take a village of people to do this exhibition and to think about Detroit. I also would like to thank at this moment the staff at Talbot College that were so supportive in getting this exhibition not only to Venice, but getting it back here, in particular our project manager, Denise McGee.
Otherwise known as a force of nature.
And of course, having Elise Jaffe and Jeffrey Brown volunteer to support a very special catalog means that the ideas that these architects worked on in 2015 and 2016 for this exhibition, for Venice, for Detroit, and by the way, this exhibition is going to Los Angeles after Detroit, because people do want to learn what happens in this city and what doesn't happen, I should add. That all of this takes a great effort by a lot of individuals that we can't even begin to name here, although I would like, as Monica said, these architects were volunteering their time, and it's extraordinary the amount of time they did put into this, and all of them that are here today are here also at their own expense, and I'm very grateful to them for that. Now, Monica has given me a little leeway here to do a closing about the power of imagination. So I have to tell first a personal anecdote. I was in Arkansas, in Fayetteville, Arkansas, in November to give a lecture about this exhibition. I didn't have Monica with me, I had to wing it by myself. It happened that the day I gave this lecture was also the weekend of the Arkansas State Architects Convention. And the Architects Convention, the people organizing it, had asked school children in Arkansas to make placemats to be at the dinner for the architects that evening. And this one of the architects who attended that dinner, I happened to see the next day at breakfast, we had had a planned meeting, and he brought me this placemat. And I thought, well, okay, this is nice, it's like a McMansion, there's a basketball hoop, the trees are quite original. I didn't know quite what I was supposed to think about this, and he said, turn it over. On the back, these children had to explain to the architects why they drew what they drew. And Owen Winter, who is 10 years old, said, I just thought of a little house on a field, but then my imagination just hit me. And I think about what Marshall Brown said last night about why he did a school for the Quinder Cut. Because Marshall said, the children, when we make decisions about architecture in cities, are never in the room. There are obvious reasons they're not in the room. They don't know enough, they're too young, they couldn't sit still, they couldn't stand the arguments, etc. But we do build for those children. We are building for the future. So one last image. Many of you know the work of Carrie James Marshall, a painter born in Birmingham, Alabama, who now lives and works in Chicago. We had a major retrospective last year at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago, and whose work I saw when it came to New York to the Met Broyer this autumn. And this is a painting called Chicago Now, with a family setting up to have a picnic with the projects, the public housing of Chicago in the background. This particular painting is from a series he did on public housing and its condition and the lives people have to live in these houses, many of which are ironically named gardens, Madison Gardens. I forget the names, I should have written them down. But here, this painting of Chicago, and if you know Grant Park, and you know Lake Michigan, you see maybe a little bit of a different kind of garden, a little bit of a different kind of recreational pursuit. It's very different from the other paintings in this series. And this painting also, if you look very closely to the music that these people are listening to, can you read it? It says, it's just my imagination running away with me. Thank you. Robert, that's the audacity of imagination. So now we'll see what Maurice Cox has to say. Thank you.
So good evening. Thank you, Monica and Cynthia, for a fantastic framing of this pretty extraordinary exhibition. And I know it must feel incredibly rewarding to see the turnout tonight and many days ahead when Detroit gets to change the conversation about Detroit. And so there were a number of things in this exhibition and the framers that caught my attention, but there were two quotes specifically that spoke to me. One was by Cynthia and talked about Detroit as a locus of intervention and the potential for reinvention. And that spoke to me because, as you all know, Detroit has been the locus of invention, whether it be music or manufacturing, and the potential is still there for it to be the locus of another kind of reinvention. And I believe that's the reinvention of the American city. The other quote was, this notion of imagination today as being the staging ground for action and not only for escape. So somehow the notion that imagination is ground zero for action. And how do you take utopian ideas and ground them in the reality that we all live so that they might actually change someone's life? Many institutions of architecture have wrestled with how do you educate designers to take on these kind of visionary tasks of reimagining the world. My alma mater, Cooper Union, is one of them. The Graduate School of Design is another, which is kind of fascinating to see these two words juxtapose, visionaries and grounded next to each other. We don't often think of them being complementary. And yet, I think it speaks volumes to the kind of humility, the kind of empathy, and concern for equity that visionaries have to have in order to impact folks' lives. So Detroit is certainly not new to visionary 20th century ideas. Charles Blessing, who was a planning director for 25 plus years, was during the 60s a part of that heroic generation that dared to dream utopian dreams of the new modern city. And so what you see here is a newspaper clipping of what today is Cobo Hall, the convention center, and a collection of modernist buildings that form a monumental complex. And this is Cobo Hall and this section of town today. So sometimes these utopian visions get built, and they're not always what they were intended to be. The interiority of Cobo Hall is something that sucks the life out of the city, and the collection of buildings that were beautifully orchestrated in the design are illegible in the public realm today. Another, by contrast, is Lafayette Park, another utopian vision of a neighborhood or the city in a park by Mies van der Rohe. It happens to be the place where I live and a number of my neighbors here tonight. But there's a key in those images that Mies van der Rohe saw the union of architecture and landscape architecture as a part of his symphony of perfect balance. And so I would argue that this vision is one that was grounded in a reality that not architecture alone, but allied disciplines would make for an extraordinary composition. So since then, there's been another narrative in Detroit. And this is one of a love affair of the notion of a city dying, dying before our very eyes, and our fixation with decay and ruin. And this, in many ways, has been the dominant narrative for decades now. Much like Bill Clinton said in the 90s, it's the economy, stupid. Mayor Duggan has said it's the neighborhoods, stupid. The rebirth of Detroit is going to be in its neighborhoods. And this affords us an opportunity to kind of pivot and speak about what created this extraordinary city. It was first and foremost the locus of the American dream. The black middle class was built here in Detroit. And 50 years later, that middle class is still here, and they are planning to stay. And so the question is, how do we build a reality that allows them to stay and to raise their families here? So I would contend that there's a no-build option that we are obligated to address. It has to do with this extraordinary quantity of vacant land that we have been given that I believe constitutes our competitive advantage and the opportunity to reinvent the American city. So just a few examples of what it means to have a vision and have it be grounded in the reality of neighborhoods is this diagram by Elizabeth Mosses, the Australian landscape architect, for a quarter square mile in the Fitzgerald neighborhood in northwest Detroit. She envisions a quilt, a typology of productive land, parcels that knit the neighborhood back together and gives an intentionality to over 20 acres of vacant land with 100 houses rehabbed. And so the notion is to reimagine an American neighborhood without building a single new structure. And I think that this is one of the challenges that we face. The other, and those of you who live here know, that Detroit has probably the largest inventory of vacant buildings in the country. Literally thousands of buildings, dozens of churches, factories, and schools. There are over 50 vacant schools in the city, waiting for their reuse, waiting for their new programs. And so one has to ask the question, in the face of thousands of vacant buildings, what is the charge of the architect? But there is a place, I believe, for architecture in reinvention, and that is a place where Detroit actually didn't build a lot, and that is that missing middle density, that fabric of what the fabric of which neighborhoods are made. So another example of a grounded visionary idea is to rebuild a quarter square mile of brush park with these first block and a half vision of medium density housing done by five different architects with the sole purpose of constructing a contemporary neighborhood that understands some of the traditional forms of some of the grand neighborhoods of Detroit. And then lastly, where these come together, at the Detroit River and the heart of the city. And is it possible to find a union between the public space and the need to define, as architecture can, the public realm? And so this was the site, is the site of a collaboration between the city of Detroit, the Riverfront Conservancy, its Skidmore and Merrill, and the Parisian landscape architect Michel Denis. And that is to try to imagine a new American landscape on the face of the Detroit River, our central park, where architecture can do its part in defining the public realm and a new ecologically driven landscape might be united. So I end with a notion and a belief in the architectural imagination, but also that we are charged to make no small plans. They have no magic to stir men's blood. And in fact, the purpose of this exhibition and our work as grounded visionaries is to unleash the architectural imagination and inspire Detroit. Thank you.